And so it's hard to do candles outside and fire in this kind of breezy situation. So I would love for you to help me create some imagery that captures the idea of the wind, the spirit as wind. And so if you have wind doodads that you're willing to bring out and plunk into this grassy area, I would love for you to contribute to that. They don't have to be red, but I would love for you to wear red or orange or other flamey kind of colors like that. Umbrella's perfect, actually. There we go. She's early for Pentecost. So that's on the 23rd. And then, of course, the next week we flip into our traditional summer schedule. So 8:30 out on the beach and 11 o'clock inside. So we're getting close to that. On the 26th, that is a Wednesday evening, 5:30. We want as many of us as we can get out here gathered kind of in this area. Imagine tables and chairs and food and people actually gathered together enjoying those things. I can hardly wait. Fellowship dinner, for real. Purple Onion will cater. And then we have work to do. Shoot. No. Yay! We have work to do. We need to have a congregational meeting so that we can elect an elder to fill an unexpired term. And we are going to talk about the mission study work that has been happening in small groups and those surveys that I've been bugging everybody to fill out, and how that all fits into the process of finding the next pastor for Shiloh Presbyterian Church. So, want all of you here for that. To make sure that we have food for you and a seat for you, you need to call and let us know you're coming. We're not going to set a limit. We want to make sure that tables are expansive. But we do need to know you're coming so that we can set a place for you. May 26th. All right, so the last announcement-y thing. When you came in and got your bulletins, did you also get a couple of little cards? And a writing implement? Okay, if you did not, there is, okay. You got it covered? Thank you, thank you. All right, so you don't need them right now, but don't lose them and don't let the wind carry them away, because later in the service, I'm going to ask you to do some work. Because that's part of worship too, the work of the people. So there is a purpose for those, and I will ask you to pull those out later, kind of after the sermon. And I think, unless somebody else knows of an announcement that needs making, we are ready.
What do we do with our card?
Oh, I'll give them instructions for that later. All right. Let's prepare our hearts and our minds for worship together.
Join us in the call to work.
Please join us in the call to worship. Easter people, have you heard the news?
Christ is here in our hearts, in our lives, and in our midst.
Christ is our companion on this road of faith.
We come ready for Christ to open our eyes. Hallelujah. Let us worship God.
Holy Companion, The resurrection story of Easter takes our breath away. Life overcomes death, love shatters fear, and peace prevails against empire. We give you thanks and praise. Alleluia.
True companion, we know when your spirit is at work within and between us, for you bring food to the hungry, hope to the despairing, and support to the challenged.
We give you thanks and praise. Alleluia. Kind companion, when we forget we bear the mark of your grace and act as if you have no claim on our lives, forgive us.
When you call us to the risky world of justice and peace, but we default to what is comfortable and safe,
forgive us. When you call us to ministries of generosity and compassion, but we make little room in our lives for gestures of mercy, forgive us.
Buen companador, open our eyes that we may recognize you in our conversations. Open our ears that we may follow the sound of your voice, and make our hearts burn with courage that we may do good as we serve and shepherd and speak while walking side by side with our neighbors, for our neighbors, and for you.
Alleluia. Amen.
Friends, hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us, and Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old is gone, and the new has begun. Believe this very good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Amen.
This time to a letter to the church in Galatia. And last week, in our passage from Acts, we got Luke's account of what happened when Peter and Paul addressed the Jerusalem Council. There was, as you might recall, a conflict about what was required of new Gentile believers. Those folks who committed to following Jesus but had not been part of the Jewish tradition. And I mentioned that the matter was settled for right then, but not forever. There would continue to be some tension. Paul's letter to the Galatians gives us a Paul's eye view of that issue. And we're going to start today's reading at Galatians 1, verse 13. Listen for the word of God. You have heard, no doubt, of my earlier life in Judaism. I was violently prosecuting the Church of God and was trying to destroy it. I advanced in Judaism beyond many among my people of the same age, for I was far more zealous for the traditions of my ancestors. But when God, who had set me apart before I was born and called me to His grace, was pleased to reveal His Son to me, so that I might proclaim Him among the Gentiles, I did not confer with any human being, nor did I go up to Jerusalem to those who were already apostles before me, but I went away at once to Arabia, and afterward I returned to Damascus. All right, so we get a little bit of Paul's autobiography here. Then he goes on and describes a meeting that he had 14 years later, which probably was that Jerusalem Council. In which he and the apostles came to that agreement on what he was preaching, that it was actually the gospel, and also what was to be expected from those Gentile believers. So we fast-forwarded through a lot of words there. All right, and we're going to pick it back up in chapter 2. But when Cephas, that's Peter, came to Antioch, I opposed him to his face, because he stood self-condemned. For until certain people came from James, he used to eat with the Gentiles. But after they came, he drew back and kept himself separate for fear of the circumcision faction. And the other Jews joined him in this hypocrisy, so that even Barnabas was led astray by their hypocrisy. But when I saw that they were not acting consistently with the truth of the gospel, I said to Cephas before them all, if you, though a Jew, live like a Gentile and not like a Jew, how can you compel the Gentiles to live like Jews? We ourselves are Jews by birth and not Gentile sinners. Yet we know that a person is justified not by the works of the law, but through faith in Jesus Christ. And we have come to believe in Christ Jesus so that we might be justified by faith in Christ, not by doing the works of the law, because no one will be justified by the works of the law. But if in our effort to be justified in Christ, we ourselves have been found to be sinners, is Christ then a servant of sin? Certainly not. But if I build up again the very things that I once tore down, then I demonstrate that I am a transgressor. For through the law, I died to the law so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but it is Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and who gave himself for me. I do not nullify the grace of God, for if justification comes through the law, then Christ died for nothing. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
This tune we're going to sing is rather familiar to you all, and we hope that you'll participate in joining us in singing the refrain, which is, Yes, Jesus Loves Me, and also join us in the singing the final verse that's found in your bulletin.
Randy, that's not what we practiced. We were going to do a more upbeat style, weren't we?
I know, but I'm feeling kind of embarrassed. There's a lot of people out there that have been trained classically in music, in church music, and I just kind of feel embarrassed playing that upbeat stuff. So,
play it the way we practice it, Randy.
Break away to try something new just because your classical trained friends are around you, how can we ask all these people to sing Jesus Loves Me in a different style?
And it's all about God sending his son to, you know, love us and show us the way. So let's play it like we practice it, Randy.
Yes, Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me. Oh, yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
Sometimes, don't we? Ask you to sing new words to a familiar tune. Ask you to sit in chairs in a parking lot. Ask you to wear face coverings. Do things that are uncomfortable or weird or odd. Yeah, change is hard. Change can be hard. On the surface, this conversation, this letter that Paul is having with the people in Galatia, it looks like just that argument about circumcision or about no longer needing to follow other laws and traditions that the Hebrew people had kept for generations, really. And one of the ways that we can get off track when we think about our Jewish forebears and even our Jewish siblings today is how we think about that relationship between faith and works. First century Jews, generally speaking, they did not aim for perfection in keeping the law. Paul was kind of an overachiever when he describes himself that way. That was not their means of being justified, of being in right relationship with God. They shared the belief that Paul was teaching, that they were saved by grace, and that righteousness, that right relationship with God, was made known, was made manifest by obedience to Jewish law. They believed, and they showed it. So when Paul talks about the works of the law in this passage, he's thinking about very specific set of ordinances, the ones that set them apart as people and guide them toward obedience of God, like that requirement for men to be circumcised. But above and beyond those particular rituals for belonging, Jewish believers saw the law as a means of responding with love to God's grace, not a means of salvation. Does that sound familiar? I hope it does, because that is the tradition that we have received. We are saved by grace through faith, not by works. There is not a single stinking thing that we can do to earn salvation. Jesus has that covered. And it is even the Spirit that gives us the capacity to trust that that is true. Not ours. Job. You feel me? I'm like, this is helpful. Yeah, okay, because I can't go on if I don't know that we're okay there. All right, so we're there. All right, Jesus didn't say, go and make disciples and baptize them, but don't be bothered by any of those things that I taught you about the commandments. Right? Jesus said, go and make disciples, baptizing them and teaching them all that I have commanded. When they've heard that good news, when they repent, when they confess, when they are baptized, teach them then how they should live in gratitude for that tremendous grace. Teach them then how they should live so that they can be part of God's team of people out there making the world whole, healing the wounds made by our disconnect from God. When we learn about the law in the context of that kind of loving relationship, it's not a burdensome checklist. It's clarity. It's how do we love God and our neighbors? Well, we do these things. It points back to the law and the prophet. It doesn't negate them. So, Paul wants something. Otherwise, he would not be fussing about this. Right? He's really ticked off at Peter. So what's the problem? Well, the problem is that Paul does not want what Peter's up to and Barnabas and those other guys to set up this false hierarchy of who's better at being a follower of God, the Jews or the Gentiles. Now, how's Peter doing that? Well, he's been hanging around with these Gentiles. He's been eating with them. He's been living like a Gentile, meaning he wasn't doing all of those things that he was taught coming up in Hebrew school, right? He wasn't worried about all those rituals so much as, hey, let's make sure you understand the commands of Christ. Let's make sure people have food. Let's make sure that all is good in our community. And in come these folks who are saying, look, it's all well and good that you want to follow Jesus, but you have to do this. You've got to be circumcised. You have to follow these particular parts of the law. And Peter's looking at his friends over there, those Gentiles, and they've not been doing that. And where does he stand? Here. Not here. And now he's going to tell those guys that he has not told them before. Okay, so here's the thing. You have to do this, 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 and this. This is what ticks Peter off. I mean, ticks Paul off. He says, Peter, dude, you've been over here living like a Gentile all this time, which means that you understand that God's grace, the work of the Spirit, all these signs and wonders that are happening here are proof that God is in their midst. And it is good. And that's all they need to do. Keep living as you are. And now you're going to stand over here and you're going to say, well, you know, these people are seeing me teach and they're seeing me tell them. And so I got to toe the line. Yikes. Yikes. I say yikes because guilty as charged. Guilty as charged. How many ways have I left my friends behind because I'm worried about judgmental looks? I'm worried about those eyebrows going up. I'm worried about what people might be saying about me when I stand with those folks who need more desperately than anybody over there to know the grace and love of God. Where do I stand? Where does God ask me to stand? Yeah, because that's where Jesus stood. That's where he ate, at that table with those sinners, not with the ones who knew that they were good with God because they had done all the right things and because they had the right surname and because, you know, they looked a certain way. Jesus wanted to make sure that those who thought they were not worthy understood that God had already made them worthy. Yikes. Paul helped Peter come to that realization. Catch how he did it. The NRSV tells us that he kind of got face to face with him. He got in his face. He got in his face and said, Peter, dude, you can't be doing this to your friends. You have got to stand with them because your witness is diminished when you choose to stand over there. Your witness is diminished. You will diminish the work of the Spirit among the people you've been called to serve. And you know that this is true. So Peter had to lay some things down. Peter had to say, it's all right for them to think less of me so that I can make sure that these people know that they are equal. That's a pretty big ask. It's all right if they say and make reports about what I'm up to back with their friends in Jerusalem. It's all right if they do that. I'm just going to lay that down. And you know what? Tomorrow I'm going to lay it down again. I might have to come back again. Because that one's hard. Because you know what that's attached to? That's that shame monster that lives in us. That tells us that we are not worthy. And Jesus weeps. Because the truth is, my friends, you are worthy, and so are our neighbors. And so are the people who make us cranky and say words that we ought not say. I'm gonna lay that down. There's an awful lot we have to lay down if we're going to move forward in the world with Christ. And it's not all about churchy stuff. Some of it is fear of the unknown. Some of it is fear of change. Some of it is wanting to hold on to those things that make us comfortable because, well, they make us comfortable. And some of that stuff, we don't even know why we do it. But it makes us comfortable because rituals and traditions and the way things always have been allow us some sense of, well, that's the way the world's always going to be. And the truth is, my friends, as we approach Pentecost, we've got to be ready for the fact that the Spirit changes things and changes them on a dime. Thanks be to God.
Hallelujah.
Because the world has got to change. We cannot continue as we are. All of those things that you right now just thought of, it's not the way the world has to be. And it's not the way the world is meant to be. And the way that the world gets from there to there, from the way it always has been, to the way it is now, and on into the way that Jesus wants this world to be, is that we come out here. We come out here in the power of the Holy Spirit and leave aside those things that made us comfortable for so long, and leave aside those looks that come askance at us, and leave aside the shame of being out on the bleeding edge of making the world a better place. And yikes. Yikes, because what does that even look like? I don't know, but you know who knows? God knows. And you know who hears? God's people hear. God's people hear God's call out into the future, even if that future is very wildernessy. And the only way that we can hear those things is if we make space for it. If we make space in our hearts and in our minds for visions that are new. If we make space in our hearts and our minds for people who are new and not already here. If we make space in our hearts and in our minds for ideas that seem, well, pretty bonkers, then and only then is there space for God to speak without whacking us upside the head with a 2x4. And if we don't make that space, guess what God will do? Get ready for 2x4. My friends, those cards that you got, and pencils, this is where you're going to pull them out. Because we're going to go into a time of prayer and ask God to begin speaking to us. And our first step in asking God to speak to us is actually asking God to help us to lay some things down. And so as our worship leaders guide us through a time of contemplation, through a litany of things that we might consider laying down, I want you to kind of think about your household, think about the church, the great big church, your neighborhood, our communities, our nation, and consider what it is that we might need to let go of, to release, to lay down, so that we can hear God speaking to us and are moving forward. Let us be in an attitude of prayer.
Let us lay down
those things which divide and dull our relationships together that cause conflict of little worth.
Let us lay down those issues that are more about us than about the love of God.
Let us lay down the words we have said that have hurt those we spoke them to. Let us lay down
the grudges we cling onto from ages past.
Let us lay down
the fear of straying faith
to areas in which we have no experience.
Let us lay down our fear of a future that is not comfortable and familiar.
Let us lay down
the anger we have
of those who wish to remain with what is familiar
and with those who wish to explore further.
Let us lay down
that which is unloving
and does not bring life.
I'm not sure what's harder, picking things up or laying them down. But I know that when you call us to pick up the cross and follow you, that the only way we can do that is to lay down the burdens that we are carrying. And so as we consider what you are calling us to do, let us not skip over the work of getting rid of those things that you're calling us to lay down, to release, to let go of. Lord, we know that that is the way that change happens, and as scary as change is, staying the same can actually be even more daunting in a world that is rapidly changing around us. And so help us, Lord, to give you our hearts, to give you our minds, to give you our whole selves in ways that are honest and true and complete and loving and faith-filled. It is your truth alone, loving God, that can change hearts, your healing power that can transform troubled souls, your spirit that can move mountains of despair. So we pray today, Lord, for change in places where tradition has a stranglehold on vision, where fear prevents the hope of a better future, where injustice is ingrained and the same voices shout the loudest. Lord, let there be change. We pray for transformation in hearts left cold by hurt, in lives destroyed by loneliness, in bodies held ransom by pain, and souls crying out for relief. Lord, let there be transformation. We pray for healing for those troubled in body, mind, and spirit. May they know your presence in the comfort of others and in your timeless promises made real in Christ Jesus, our Savior. Lord, let there be healing. We pray for movement. Movement in our churches, Lord, that the past may not dictate the present or the possible. Movement in our communities, that ingrained opinions may be challenged and shaken. Movement in our world, that reconciliation and peace might become an achievable reality and not just a dream for the hopeful. Lord, let there be movement. And we pray, Lord, for ourselves here in this congregation, that we might together offer help, hope, and encouragement to one another and to those in need. And may you continue to meet us, Lord, along the pathways of life, that our faith might be strengthened, making us worthy workers for the kingdom. And now we join our voices together praying the prayer your Son taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We don't start playing. All right, so the thing is, those thoughts that you scribbled, they're not just yours, because you are part of a whole, and we together are listening for God, and we together will lay these things down, and I'm going to use these lovely pieces of paper later. So, Steve is going to walk around with a basket, and you can wave to him, or if you would like in a moment to come up after we've said the benediction and put yours here, you can lay it down where I've been laying down my stuff. Right there.
Spirit, we trust you to guide us.
Because you promised.
promise to work through us, even us, to transform the fabric of this world. Jesus,
we know you will walk with us, accompanying us today and always.
Amen. Friends, go in peace. Amen.